Celebrating the connection with our pets. This is Animal Radio, featuring your dream team, veterinarian Dr. Debbie White and groomer Joey Villani. And here are your hosts, Hal Abrams and Judy Francis.
Oh, I wish this was TV and you could see Molly, the studio stunt dog, right now, dressed up in a costume. And it's a lion mane is what it is.
She's the perfect color for it.
She just
blends in and she looks like a real little 7-pound lion.
When I first saw it, I thought that was actually her hair. I thought something had happened to her. But it's very cute. It's a Halloween costume, and Halloween's just around the corner. According to these statistics, 16% of us dress up our animals for Halloween. I believe, personally, it's a little more than that.
Yeah, I want to see that higher this year, people. Come on.
just for you, Judy.
All you yes. ladies in the studio, you definitely dress up your animals for Halloween. I don't do that. I you know how I feel about accessories and stuff. Of course, Joey, he dresses up his animals too.
You haven't just found the right outfit, because if you find that right outfit, you will say, "Oh, this is so much fun," and you'll get on board. I guarantee you.
See, Hal doesn't know, but I took one of his cats and I put a red cape on him. And he ran and strutted. And
I think he was trying to get away from you.
No, he wanted to see everybody. He wanted to greet people at the door. He wanted everybody to see him. He thought he looked hot in that red cape.
Okay, well, I bring it up because in my hot little hands is a mermaid costume. This is so cute. If I'm going to dress up my animals, God forbid, this might be the costume that I would put one of my dogs in. It's a beautiful sequined mermaid costume, which will be given away to you. Yes, you, looking down at your radio before the end of the show today as we talk to an expert on costuming your pets. She makes weird and unique costumes. That's on the show today. Also, another inventor with a great idea, pop-up pee pads.
Wow, why didn't I think of that?
Pop-up pee pads. You know what? I'm just going to let you imagine what that might be, and you stick around and you'll find out what it's all about coming up before the end of the show today. Lori, what are you working on over there in the newsroom?
There's a big animal advocate group that is doing a first. They are going to court against the practice of pet leases.
Damn straight. I hate those.
Yes,
yeah,
I know you
outlawed.
Do.
Okay, let's go to the phones for your calls first. Toll free 1-866-405-8405. Well, hello there, Kathy. How are you doing?
How are you?
Good. Are you on a speakerphone?
No, I'm wearing my headset.
Oh, okay. Are you in the bathroom?
No, was it echoing? I'm in a small room.
Okay, now you sound great. So where are you calling from today?
I'm calling from San Luis Obispo, California.
Just down the street from us. So what's going on?
Well, what's happening is my mom just adopted, my mom who's quite elderly, mm-hmm. just adopted, and I helped her find a new cat, or a cat for her to have as a companion.
Okay.
And the cat is 8 years old, and her elderly lady passed away. And in the last couple of years, this happened 2 years ago, and since then she just kind of got bounced around, and well, she got abandoned at first. Her elderly lady died, and then she just got dumped outside by the family, and then she fortunately got taken in by the Cal Poly Cat program.
Okay.
And
okay.
Yes, she's been through a couple of homes, just really through no fault of her own. But her name is Squeakers, or that's,
okay.
I think it was a nickname, but my mom really wanted to name her something nicer. And I was just wondering, at 8 years old, is it a bad thing to rename a cat, especially this poor kitty who's had so many changes?
Yeah. Well, I guess the first thing we have to realize is when we name a cat and we call them, how often do they actually come to us?
Yeah, I have a
So true. This is maybe a little bit different than a dog in that mm-hmm. the response time and the turnaround that we're going to expect with calling a cat is going to be, you know, maybe a little lower bar than we would have for a dog.
Yeah.
So, but that being said, you know, I can understand that if your mom was interested in changing her name, you know, but, you know, I just can't say that it's going to be an easy thing to get the expectation that the kitty is going to respond and come to the name.
I don't want to confuse the kitty or make her any more unsure of her situation than she might be.
I don't think it would confuse her unless our expectations made her upset. So if we call a cat and they don't come and we get angry or, you know, something about how we respond to them becomes stressful, then it would be stressful for her. But she's not going to care if she, if you call her Buffy and she doesn't come. It's not going to bother her. It might frustrate your mother, though, and that might be the thing that, you know, let's, I might just advise to not change the rules or the name so much, because it really might put your mom in more of a situation where she becomes frustrated that Kitty's not coming to her name or responding to her name in whatever way. Now, it can be done, and if you have the means to assist your mom with this, this is something you can certainly do, you know, using food as the reward to kind of retrain her. But my, like I said, my expectations would be a little bit lower, and I just don't know that. I would rather see her spend bonding time with her in other ways than, you know, trying to change her name. So it's just my two cents there.
That's good. And my mom's 92, and she kind of forgets what she wanted to call her anyway.
Yeah.
So she had a hard time with squeakers.
I see.
Yeah, but
you know, a lot of people, I mean, how many of us call a cat Kitty? And, you know, do they come to us? Maybe. You know, maybe it's more of our vocal intonation, if we're shaking something that's exciting to them. So that might be the things that you could look at doing, you know, if your mom is struggling with that name or chooses a different one and it comes out more naturally for her. You can definitely pair that.
The kitty Squeakers slash Daisy, loves to be brushed. So I suggested to my mom that maybe she, you know, brush her or just have some kind of enjoyable time and, you know, speak her, you know, think of a name at that time, talk to her. She's getting along very well. She's not at all frightened.
That's good.
And it sounds like she'll be a great companion for your mom. So that's wonderful. And, you know, that is the power of the human-animal bond. It keeps us healthier, keeps us going, and really gives us some sense of purpose in our lives. So thank you so much for your call, Kathy. We appreciate you calling and bringing up that question.
That's a good question.
Best of luck.
And there's only one thing that my cat comes to, and that's the can opening. That is, you can call call him anything, and that's the only thing. So there you go, 1-866-405-8405 to reach out to the Dream Team. Also, if you have a Yorkshire Terrier, a Shih Tzu, a Pug, or a Mini Schnauzer, don't forget to pick up Dr. Debbie's books, How to Be Your Dog's Best Friend. They're available over at Amazon as Kindle books, and we have links from animalradio.com. And let's head back to the phones, toll-free 1-866-405-8405. Who's this?
This is Sherry from Oregon.
Hey, Sherry, how are you doing?
Excellent. You?
Good. What's going on?
Well, I have three little dogs, two Chihuahuas and a Yorkie. They're all females, and they get along really good for the most part, but every once in a while they really get into it. I mean, the teeth showing and everything, and I'm just kind of wondering if I should break that up or leave them alone and let them figure out what they need to figure out.
Well, it kind of depends here. So what are the squabbles over, do you know?
Usually it's a toy, and they have certain places on the bed where they lay. And if one of them gets in the other one's place, especially at nighttime in the middle of the night, if one of them gets in the other one's place and they go to get back in there after they've gone out and potted, then they get mad at each other like, that's my spot.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, should you break up fighting dogs? You know what? My opinion is I would rather them talk it out than them fight it out. So your job is to actually anticipate what is going to set them off and what are the problematic areas. So it's far better to not allow it to escalate to the point where we could actually have an injury. Now, if they're talking it out, they might, you know, non-verbally, they might give each other a look, there might be a little grumble, and it should cease there. So there should always be a point where dogs defer to another one. So, hey, that's your favorite spot. Okay, I got it. That's your favorite toy. Okay, cool. And if they don't, then we don't want to yell at them. We don't want to scream, say, hey, stop that. because that mm-hmm. can actually make their anxiety worse in those situations. But that's where you can help to try to direct their behavior. So if there is a particular toy, making sure that that is separate, where we won't have a squabble over that. If okay. coming in the back door means they're going to have a spot that they're going to all go running for and jump, then we control their entry and maybe separate them so that we don't mm-hmm. have those squabbles.
Okay.
But a lot of this also depends on you being the leader in the household and making sure that they understand that, hey, when mom's around, we don't have to fight because everything's all figured out. So a lot of times I find that dogs will tend to fight, you know, over attention for the family members, you know, sitting on laps, things like that, sitting next to you. Mm-hmm. So that's mm-hmm. goes back to where you just need to make sure that each and every one of them understand that you got it, you're in charge, and
yeah,
the rules.
They all have their space on mom's lap. It is hilarious. And they don't really fight over that. But, you know, people say that, well, I don't, I'd say that when I say people, that dogs can't get jealous. And I believe that they can.
Well, they definitely have the things that are important to them, whereas another dog might not have something that's important to them. So, mm-hmm. yeah. So, but I would have to say that, you know, these particular things, items, spots, it's really important to recognize that when this is happening, and we want to make sure we don't yell at someone who's doing the right thing in the right situation. So, you know, right. if you've got one dog that's already lying on a spot and the other dog,
yeah.
it's her favorite spot, she really wants up there and she growls or snaps, that is not an appropriate response. So no matter whose favorite spot is, we don't want to reinforce the dog that is acting inappropriately or aggressively. So it doesn't matter whose favorite spot is. If you're growling and snapping and acting a fool, that is not appropriate and you're not going to get what you want.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Hi, this is Brandon McMillan on Animal Radio, and be sure to adopt and not shop.
Fido Friendly Magazine presents the 10th annual cross-country pet adoption tour. Get your licks on Route 66. Powered by Nissan, the tour travels from Los Angeles to Chicago, stopping at shelters along the way to support adoption events. Companion sponsors Tito's Vodka and Dog Legs join in the fun as media sponsor Animal Radio broadcasts the tour from September 8th to October 14th. Pet Box sponsor Paw Pack and pet insurance sponsor Embrace Pet Insurance support the tour, along with advocate sponsors Buddy Belts, Pecurian, Hands-On Gloves, and Rolf C. Hagen. Attendees at each event stand in line to donate money and spin our giant spinning wheel, filled with great prizes they can win, provided by sponsors like Community Sponsors, Cosequin Joint Health Supplements, PetMate, Dexis, Senden, and Canidae, where all proceeds benefit the shelter at the end of the day. Log on to FidoFriendly.com and find out where the tour stops near you. And who knows, you might just find your new forever friend.
And now an Animal Radio news brief.
A Colorado woman's been arrested on suspicion of animal cruelty after she allegedly shoved her Chihuahua puppy down her pants. The incident occurred during a domestic dispute in which police found Jonah Turner arguing with a man. According to the NBC affiliate KUSA in Denver, Turner had agreed to leave the premises but insisted on taking her dogs with her. Well, where else are you going to stuff a Chihuahua but down your pants? Police arrived. Eyewitnesses told them to search Turner's pants, and when they did, a Chihuahua fell out. The puppy was unharmed, but Turner was charged with one count of misdemeanor animal cruelty. She pleaded not guilty. Maybe she was trying to save that puppy's life, and that was the best place to put it, because nobody wanted to go down her pants to find it. Who knows? All right. I'm Stacey Cohen. Get more animal breaking news at animalradio.com.
This has been an Animal Radio news brief. Get more at animalradio.pet.
You're listening to Animal Radio. If you missed any part of today's show, visit us at animalradio.com or download the Animal Radio app for iPhone and Android.
We are so proud to have the dog father, Joey Villani, on Animal Radio, straight from the Groomer Protection Program, which protects them from other groomers. Apparently, you've made some enemies by giving out tips and, you know, advice that could actually hurt some of your friends and you financially, of course, right?
Yeah, you know what? I mean, sometimes they get leaked out because, you know, other people on the show leak out my secrets. But other times, a lot of times, you know, I give them out. Because we want your pet to look the best they possibly can.
Absolutely.
You know, that's it's an extension of you. If your pets look great, you know, you think the you know, the people look great. And when your pet looks like a stroopy-eyed, you know, and the person looks like a stroopy-eyed.
So true. So
a
true.
What? A what?
Stroopy-eyed. You know what that is.
It's a stroopy-eyed.
No,
like,
no, I don't.
It's a tie-in for like, I don't know, like slob, you know, like, I don't know. It's slang. New Jersey Italian slang is what it is.
Yes.
Okay. So I want to talk about something because, you know, it's funny that you're even talking about this because you don't know my tips, but I want to talk about accessorizing
okay.
so your pet actually stands out. You know, it's funny because there's a lot of little things that you can do to your pet because people always ask me, you know, what can I do to make my pet look different? And there's only so many haircuts you can do, only so many times you can brush, comb, but there's a lot of things you can do. I mean, if you look online now, they make all kinds of bows, barrettes, bandanas, color, hair extensions with colors, for your pet now. And these are things that are real easy to apply.
Hair extensions. Now,
yeah, they're called. Well, this isn't actually anything that's new. This is something that breeders have been doing for a while, and they're called whips, where they would actually put them in a poodle's top knot to give a top knot.
I'm sorry, I'm not familiar with that.
top knot is the hairpiece on top of the poodle's head.
Okay,
and it's called a top knot.
Uh-huh.
And you know, to give it a much fuller appearance, it's been used for a while, but now it's been brought to the, you know, general public, where, you know, they can have a little bit of fun with it, and you know, just like you ever see women with those
hair extensions
you
can sure.
buy. No, but the ones that you can buy like in Claire's or something, you know, where they could just add a little bit of hair. It's basically just like that. They clip right in. They look great, and you know, some have feathers, some have different colors.
What do the dogs think of it? Do they think, oh, what's that thing hanging on my fur?
I think that sometimes they're a little bit like, you know, what's going on? But the attention that they get, you know, a lot of people say that it's unfair for the pet because they can't. But I got to be honest with you. I mean, what I have seen is the pets actually love the attention that they end up getting, you know, from it. Because it is an attention grab. I mean, you see a dog that has pink and purple, you know, splashes of color in it, and their hair extensions, or just something that looks different, whether that be feathers, barrettes, bows, bandanas, you know, or I mean, there's so many different types of accessories. I can go on and on and on and on. But if you want to jazz your pet up, it's real easy to do.
Okay. That's, you know, Judy loves that kind of stuff. And Lori, do you dress your dogs up? Do any kind of accessorizing with your dogs?
All the time.
Do you really?
You haven't seen my new Facebook profile picture?
No, I meant...
I put 4 dress-up pictures in 1 profile picture.
See, I wish I could do something like that to Ladybug, but she doesn't have any hair to clip to. So I can't put any extensions on her. Maybe a wig. They do have those wigs. I could try one of those.
You know what you'll like, Judy, is today we're having somebody on who makes costumes, Halloween costumes.
Because how fun.
But they have come along so far in the last few years.
Uh-huh.
There's this one that looks exactly like a lion's mane, and you put it on your dog. Your dog looks like...
Uh-huh.
We're going to give away some of those today. And I guess that's sort of accessorizing once a year.
Yeah. You know, I have to say, I worked for a vet years ago, and there were 2 Rottweilers that would come in together, and they were actually police dogs.
Uh-huh.
But in their downtime, when they weren't working, they had a chest full of costumes, and they would go over and open the chest and pull out a costume for their owner to put on them because they loved wearing their costumes.
Hmm. Okay.
My dogs love... Funny. My dogs would cry to get their costumes on.
Really?
You know, costumes
really?
Came, oh, yes. Especially when I had Miles. Miles would cry and couldn't wait. I mean, he couldn't wait till you put the... you know, when I was married, Elaine used to put it was like a collar with bells on it, and he would love this collar. When the collar with bells came out, he would go crazy. He loved it. And he'd prance around the house.
Oh, they know the attention they get.
Okay. Toll-free 1-866-405-8405. I guess I'm the only sane one here, right? Tell me. Call me. Let me know if I'm off the rocker here or what. Should I be doing more accessorizing or dressing my animals in tutus? Let me know. This healthy serving of Animal Radio is brought to you by the grain-free Red Barn Naturals canned food for dogs and cats. Always made in the USA with natural, functional ingredients to support your pet's optimal health. Learn more at redbarninc.com. And thanks, Red Barn, for underwriting Animal Radio.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Do you travel with your dog?
Of course. My pets are part of our family.
Me too. I take Daisy with me everywhere. Right, Daisy? So how do you find out what hotels welcome your dog?
I read Fido Friendly, the travel and lifestyle magazine for you and your dog.
Sounds perfect for planning our next vacation. Right, Daisy?
It is. Their motto is Leave No Dog Behind, and they have great hotel and destination reviews.
Where can I find the magazine?
Go online to FidoFriendly.com.
I will for sure. Come on, Daisy. We're off to find our next adventure.
This is an Animal Radio News Update.
I'm Lori Brooks. The Food and Drug Administration has issued a warning that some medications in the isoxazoline class, those meds like Bravecto, Credelio, Nexgard and Simparica, that those drugs may do more than just combat flea and tick infestations, because they're saying it turns out they all have the potential of causing seizures, muscle tremors, or other neurological problems in pets. Pretty darn scary. The FDA says the drugs are safe to use for most animals, but they have issued this warning recommending that pet parents talk to their veterinarian and review their pet's medical history. Wow. Now, although most dogs and cats haven't had neurologic adverse reactions, seizures can still occur in animals without a prior history of reactions. That means if they have received an isoxazoline flea or tick treatment before and didn't have a reaction, that they could still have a reaction to it in the future. Kind of like seafood for some people.
Wow. So the FDA came out with that. They're usually pretty lenient, so it must be serious. What are the brands again?
The brands are Bravecto, Credelio, C-R-E-D-E-L-I-O, Nexgard, which you've probably heard of, and Simparica.
Yeah, we use both Bravecto and Nexgard, so we're going to have to keep an eye out. That worries me, because you know how I feel about these chemicals.
We use Bravecto as well, yes. Yeah. I totally agree.
Okay.
It's scary.
Thanks for the heads up.
We've talked a lot before, Hal, about animal leasing plans and how people often get taken by them. Mm-hmm. Well, now the ASPCA has filed a lawsuit in New Jersey on behalf of two sisters who unknowingly entered into a pet leasing agreement so that they could buy an eight-week-old golden retriever puppy from a pet store. Well, both the lender and the pet store are now targeted in this lawsuit. If you haven't heard about the leasing of pets before, it can be a very deceptive practice. Pet stores and online puppy sellers, they offer these pet leasing plans to make high-priced puppies appear more affordable within reach. Consumers may think that they're opting for a standard payment plan, you know, like a little loan, but many of these arrangements are actually leases, exactly what they say they are, where they are required to make inflated monthly payments while the leasing company retains ownership of the dog. And at the end of the lease, the consumer is then required to make an additional payment if they want to keep the dog.
Wow. You know what? If you haven't heard us talking about it before, this is the first time, do not, absolutely do not get a pet at a pet store with any kind of payment plan whatsoever. Stay away from that. And you know what? I'm glad the ASPCA is going after the pet stores, because up to this point, we've only been kind of pointing our fingers to the lenders. But the pet stores should know this is not good either.
Right. And in this case, Hal, if you didn't hear, the sisters had to pay a total of $5,300 at the end of their two-year leasing agreement. And the purchase price was $3,500. And the SBA kind of goes on to say a little bit of what you said. They believe pet leasing agreements raise significant animal welfare issues because they support the commercial breeding and retail pet store industries by making it easier to sell high-priced puppy mill dogs. Mm. Mm. I'm Lori Brooks. Get more breaking animal news anytime at animalradio.com.
This has been an Animal Radio News Update. Get more at animalradio.com.
You're listening to Animal Radio. If you missed any part of today's show, visit us at animalradio.com or download the Animal Radio app for iPhone and Android.
It's Animal Radio, celebrating the connection with our pets. And yes, you have questions for Dr. Dibby and Joey Villani. And yes, they will answer them coming up in just a couple of minutes. First, we're going to visit with Bill Klein. You may remember the TLC special, The Little Couple. Well, Bill has been on that and was one of the little couples and has now invented something that is so cool and so unique and so different. We had to share it with you. Hi, Bill. Welcome to the show.
Hey, how are you?
Very good. So I saw a picture, and the best way to understand what you've done is looking at the picture. It's real explanatory. I didn't even need to look at any of the text surrounding the picture. You have created a pee pad, a very unique pee pad, which reminds me very much of the pop-up books I used to have as a youngster. Can you explain what it is?
The pad is pretty straightforward. Male dogs, specifically small male dogs that have had a proclivity for going to the bathroom on furniture, corners of couches, fun stuff like that, no longer need to pee on the furniture anymore. This is a pad that has a target right in the middle of the pad, so that when your dog aims, there's no more cleaning up afterward.
Can you explain to listeners what the target is?
Yeah, it's a hydrant. So it's a little fire hydrant that's pre-attached to a training pad. There's an attractant on the pad. There's super absorbent material inside the pad. So it behaves like a regular pad, except as you unfold it, a fire hydrant pops up in the middle. And when the dog's done doing their business, it folds down and you can toss it.
Now, you created this out of necessity. Was it because you had an issue with one of your dogs?
Yes, ma'am. So, you know, I had a Chihuahua, little Rocky, and Rocky was our first dog me and my wife had together. And when we moved to Texas, we moved into an apartment. I was using a landline to conduct business, and my little dog didn't want to wait for me to get off of conference calls. And so as I'm on a call that I couldn't, you know, get off the phone from, my dog would look at me, pretty much eye contact made, and then pee on the corner of the furniture. And I couldn't express any sort of dismay because, of course, that would upset whomever it was I was on the phone with.
Oh.
And so I tolerate it, but of course that almost condones the behavior,
right.
And it just kind of became a vicious cycle of repetitive behavior. And so at the end of the day, I put a pad underneath the chair leg that he deemed to be worthy of him, and that was kind of the dawn of the pop-up pee pad. After that, it was just a matter of figuring out how do I come up with something that I don't have to clean. In addition to the pee pad. So,
you know, this is one of those things that I'm like, why didn't I think of this? Did you have that moment?
It's clever.
It is.
Yeah, you know, it was one of those things where, you know, I to start off with, I was thinking exactly the way you were, like a card that you received when you were a kid with the little tab that kind of made it pop up and go down. And I was messing around with my brother one day. I was stuck in traffic on my way from Orlando Airport. And I shared the idea with him. He said, well, give me a night to mess with it. Him and his wife broke out some scissors. And they helped me come up with the idea of just attaching to two parts of the pad to make it pop up instead of using some sort of action to make it pop up. And it wound up working out great. It's, you know, so we came up with the patent. We filed the patent back in 2017. We were issued a utility patent for it. And so it works out real well. And, of course, the hydrant is kind of novelty, but everybody gets it. You know, when we brought it to our first patent attorney to take a peek at, at first, he was kind of like, oh, what do you got for me today? And we unfolded it. He started laughing.
Wait. What do you got for me today? So this isn't your first invention, is it?
No. It's mine.
Okay.
I think my brother may have been to him with, you know, a number of different off-the-wall kind of oddball ideas. And so this was one of those things where, you know, I'm sure patent attorneys deal with it all the time. You know, some crazy goofball idea and it makes no sense, or it's been done a billion times. And so this was unique, but it was also simple, and he got it right away, which was great because, you know, laughter is my marketing, which is kind of amazing.
Yeah, and it's a product that you don't have to explain or have massive demonstrations for people to understand. Have any big companies come out of the woodwork and said, hey, we want to buy that patent?
Yeah, not by the patent, but we have been working with people to release the product. So I'm hoping that by the end of the year or early next year, we'll be releasing in a whole bunch of stores. But we have a few that we're working with now, and we're growing steadily, which is kind of exciting.
So does Rocky use it frequently now?
You know, Rocky is a testament to the product. You know, we made about 1,000 prototypes. Which I think at that point is considered production, but it was 1,000 prototypes that we handed out of the set. And there might be some blood on some of those, so we couldn't sell those. But we made them all by hand, and we handed them out to the people at the trade show at Global Pet. And we wanted to test the water, see what the performance was. And it was really well received, so we went right into production. But we had no need for, you know, probably 800 of these samples. So I've been using them ever since. So I buy my own product, and I also use the samples. And Rocky uses it every single day. My son now knows how to change the pads out for me. So he disposes of the one, puts out the new one. You know, with Rocky, he doesn't pee too much. Volume's kind of small, but, you know, frequent. And so it's good for two or three shots a day, and then we turn out the old pad and put up a new one. So it's pretty cool. It's pretty resilient, and I'm not only the hair club president, I'm also a member.
Sure. So we can get this at Amazon.
Yeah, you can get it at Amazon. You can get it at my store in Houston, of course. You can buy it on my site. We're at a number of different independents now, and hopefully we'll start growing into those bigger box stores so that everybody can find us.
Okay, and we'll put links over at animalradio.pet. And, of course, you can hit As Heard on Animal Radio right on the front page of animalradio.pet to find out more about the pop-up pee pad. Thank you, Bill, for hanging with us and for this amazing invention. I bow to you right now.
Thanks. I appreciate it, guys.
At Red Barn, our pet food ingredients work overtime. They aren't just there for show. Dandelion greens work to maintain a healthy digestive system. Salmon oil works to enhance the immune system. Green-lipped mussels work to support joint health. These hard-working ingredients support your dog's active, healthy life. Look at the label. We want you to. Red Barn Naturals Pet Food. Simply the best. Find it in your local pet specialty store. Try our grain-free stews. The only pet food with Red Barn Bully Sticks.
This is Animal Radio, baby.
And let's go to Jeff. Hey, Jeff, how are you doing?
Not too bad. Pretty good.
Where are you calling from today?
Right now I'm in Brooksville, Florida.
Florida, okay. And what's going on? I have the entire dream team here for you.
Well, I have a domestic short hair. She's about 21 pounds.
Holy cow.
She's always been a healthy cat, and her mother... I say her mother, my wife, she has the open buffet, which is the open food bowl. She just pours the bag of food in, and the cat eats insatiably, nonstop. I mean, we come home, and she hops down off the table and runs to the food bowl. We come out of the back of the bedroom, out of the back of the house, and she hops down off the table and runs to the food bowl.
And she stays indoors, or does she go outside?
Oh, yeah. No, she's an indoor cat.
Okay. So what's prompting you to call? Because you said she's always been big. Is there some change in her health or something that has you concerned?
I'm just curious, is the insatiable appetite, or is it just that the food's there and I'm going to eat it?
Could be a little both.
I know that's kind of...
Yeah. So the truth is that for dogs and cats, I mean, just like people, everybody has a kind of a different hunger set point when we feel like we're hungry. Some of that's set up on the type of food we eat. Some of it's genetic. Some of it's based on our activity level. So for a kitty that is, I'm going to presume that a 20 to 21 pound weight for her is excessive, that she's overweight. If I had a picture of her and I could see her, for cats that are generally that big, unless they're a Maine Coon, they're generally kind of potato shaped and they got a little head. So if that's kind of what her physique looks like, then she's going to fit into the obese category. And the sad truth is about 35% of U.S. cats are actually obese. overweight or obese.
Wow.
So it is a huge amount. And some of this is we're learning is there's some strategies and changes that we can actually adopt, do different things to help. And I think it's really important to recognize first that cats in the wild, whatever kind of cat it is, a tiger, a domestic cat that's outside, they are actually hunters. So they basically are going to go out, chase their prey, eat it and consume it. That prey is actually very high in protein and fat, but it isn't so high in carbohydrate. And, that, and in fact, if you look at what, like, you know, a mouse is made up of, a mouse is like only maybe 1 or 2% carbohydrate. And the reason this is interesting is when we look at dry food, kibble that you pour in the bowl, that is generally around 40% carbohydrate. So the difference is if we know cats are meant to be carnivores, but we pour this kibble in the bowl, that is essentially carbohydrate is energy. And if she's putting on weight, she doesn't need that level of energy. But the unfortunate thing, a lot of these high carbohydrate diets actually, they actually want to keep eating it. So we know that if we switch cats that are having this type of problem to a higher protein and limited carbohydrate diet, it actually kind of resets their hunger level because protein and fat have the benefit of affecting the speed at which the stomach empties. So it makes them feel fuller longer than if they get a lot of carbohydrate. It's kind of like, you know, if I sit down with a bag of chips, you know, I feel satisfied. I love to eat them. I'm going to keep eating them. But, you know, next I'm going to say, okay, where's my dessert now? I want more. Whereas if you eat a good protein meal, you feel a little bit more satisfied for some time. So for cats, we just have to think a little bit differently. So what this means is that if we're thinking about what's the best food for some cats, it may be best to go to a canned food because canned foods are actually much lower in the carbohydrates. There's a lot more moisture in there, which is good for their kidneys as well. So that would be one strategy that we can look at doing.
Now that sounds good, but we've tried every cat treat that's come out, just about. Mm. She won't touch any of them, but she likes chicken. I mean, cooked. Mm-hmm. She cooks it in the microwave because she doesn't want to add anything to it.
Mm-hmm.
And gives it straight up. Gives her chicken, chops it all up, makes it all mushy, and you know, pates it. I guess, but she. Yeah. She's very finicky. If she don't like it, she'll scratch the food bowl all day long.
Okay, all right. We have to dispel something right here. Fat cats are not finicky. They are masters at manipulating. They are not finicky.
Yeah,
she just knows how to ring your bell, man. That's all this is.
That so, sounds like I ring her bell. I'm the one that wants to put the lid on the open buffet at least, you know, 8 hours
yeah,
a day.
Yeah. Well,
something
okay,
that
so,
if I understand what you're saying is that if I do something like that, I need to make sure that the protein and the fat content is see, I'm gonna have to look at the food now.
Yeah, and if she's in the category of an obese cat, this is really something that I would suggest some veterinary direction for a couple reasons. One is that to help you pick the right food. And there are some great different strategies that we can go with diet, whether you do a dry food or a canned food, because there are some other even dry foods that are high in protein, lower in carbohydrates, and in fact, we use them all the time with diabetic cats, and they're very successful, sometimes putting diabetic cats in remission. So that's one thing. There's also a really wonderful weight loss food that I use from Hills called Metabolic Diet, and I really love it. I've had some cats lose a tremendous amount of weight on that. So that's another thing your veterinarian may help you with. But the other reason that it's so important not to try to handle this yourself and to change foods and be real strict is because cats, if we kind of pull the rug under them and they stop eating, they can actually go into a type of a liver condition called hepatic lipidosis. So meaning if they don't eat for a couple days, that liver tries to kind of mobilize a new energy pathway, and it can actually cause some very serious liver failure. So I would want you to work with your veterinarian on this.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Here are today's automotive news headlines. I'm Nick Miles. BMW have just shown off their car of the future, and some technologies are outstanding. The iNext interior looks like a modern living space, but if you need something like music, you just draw it on any surface of the car. By drawing a musical note, you can start your playlist, turn your music up and down by the use of an imaginary volume knob that you have drawn. Also, cameras in the vehicle allow any surface to become a screen. For more, go to ourautoexpert.com.
Think O'Reilly Auto Parts for all of your car needs. We're close, convenient, and known for our guaranteed everyday low prices and excellent customer service from professional parts people you can trust. Stop by your local O'Reilly Auto Parts today. O'Reilly Auto Parts. Better parts, better prices every day.
Celebrating the connection with our pets. This is Animal Radio, featuring your dream team, veterinarian Dr. Debbie White and groomer Joey Villani. And here are your hosts, Hal Abrams and Judy Francis.
Boom. Did that scare you? That didn't scare you. Well, this costume will. This costume, if you put it on your dog, it will scare everybody. They'll say, there's a mermaid walking around. Because it's a mermaid costume for your, maybe, Chihuahua. It's a small dog costume.
And we're small to medium.
Small to medium? Okay, yeah. We're going to give this out before the end of the hour, and we're going to find out about the inventor and what kind of other costumes she's made. They're very unique. Very, you know, you see every year the same old costumes, the hot dog and the jockey and the taco, all of those. I mean, they're cute and everything, but it's about time we freshen it up. And this lady has done that. That'll happen before the end of the show today. You know, while the gals in the studio like to dress up their animals, sometimes Halloween can be actually a bad time for your animals. It can be a scary time. Because imagine people coming to the door, which, you know, like Ladybug, she already barks like nobody's business when somebody comes to the door. But imagine that person being dressed up as the Reaper or a skeleton or something really freaky.
Oh, so yeah. A clown.
Yeah. The clowns freak me out.
Me too.
Yeah. So you want to make sure if you're dressing your animal up, if you're taking them out trick-or-treating, that, of course, they do indeed like that. Of course, around my house, I just turn off the lights so the kids don't come to the door. And I put on some music so you can't hear the kids outside screaming. And I try to keep the animals pretty calm, which, you know, can be quite
a
task.
Idea. Yeah.
Right. If your pets don't like it, then it's best to give them that kind of way to get away and not, you know, close those blinds so they don't see all the kids walking down the street. Because that would drive my dogs crazy if they were afraid of, you know, things and saw people moving in front of the house. They'd think it's their job to bark.
Yep.
The day after Halloween, do you see a chocolate poisoning over at your clinic?
You know, we see it. We see a lot of chocolate ingestions around the holidays. They're just not always. I think I can recall, you know, as a kid, you know, we used to hide the bag of chocolate for a long time to keep it away from mom and dad so they wouldn't take it. So, you know, maybe some of this would be talking to your children is that, you know, make sure the candy is stored in a safe area where your pets cannot get to it because you might be enjoying it the day after Halloween or maybe a couple weeks later. But, you know, still keep it away.
Mm-hmm. Put it in a safe area where I won't get it to it. I'm the real threat. I'll eat all your candy. Lori, what are you working on over there in the newsroom?
Just heard that a major city is going to be banning something that, gosh, is going to cause fashion chaos for the Kardashians.
Oh, no. Oh, woe is us.
Yeah.
Let's go to the phones. Toll free 1-866-405-8405. And let's go to Sam. Hey, Sam, how are you?
I'm doing great. How are you doing this morning?
Very good. Really good. Where are you calling from?
California.
California, okay. Well, I've got the whole dream team here. We're ready to answer your questions. What's going on with your animals?
You know what? I have a little, she's as big as a Pomeranian, and she's always scratching. And this started happening like a year ago. And I've taken her to the vet, and she had no fleas. And then a month ago, I took her to get her fixed, and they told me she might have a fungus.
Okay.
And I don't know, because she's always biting beginning at her tail.
Okay.
And I look, and there's nothing. You know, sometimes I find a little scab here and there, but no fleas, though. I don't know what the heck's going on.
All righty. And is there hair loss in that area?
No, just when she bites it, and, you know, she's always wet, but it's...
Is she chewing anywhere else on her body, or is it just at that tail base area?
Just that, well, sometimes I see her when she sits down, she'll scratch, and I look what she's scratching underneath her, like, by her chest, but there's no fleas or none of that, and then I take her a bath, I buy her flea collars, bleach spray, everything, nothing. Mm-hmm. And sometimes when I scratch her back, I find something like little scabs, so I did.
Okay. All right. So there's definitely, you're in an area where fleas are a big concern. So even if we don't see them, it's cheaper to treat for them. And in many cases, it can just take one flea bite that makes a pet itchy for weeks. So it's really important that you are actually treating for that. And there's some different strategies. There's the quick kill products, like things like Capstar, which is a pill that you give. There's some really wonderful new oral products as well, Bravecto, Nexgard, that work for several months at a time for flea control. But I do think that that would be important to include that, because one of the main areas we look for fleas is right at the rump area.
Right.
So I do think that's an important thing to do. The other things that I think of, especially if she's itching elsewhere, is, you know, we may have a pet that, you know, could have something like allergies. Your veterinarian mentioned something about like a fungus, like a, maybe like a yeast that she might be having on the skin. And they can get yeast or bacteria that causes them to be itchy as well. So, you know, making sure that we're treating that if they have a suspicion for that. Because itch doesn't stop with things like yeast unless you treat that.
Right.
So the other thing that we can start looking at are ways to manage itch. And for every pet, it's a little different. You know, for pets with mild, like allergy or itchings, we may try things like Benadryl with fatty acids, other antihistamines.
Benadryl?
Yeah. Now, there can be some other drugs that are more potent for itches. So, say we have a dog that we really digging themselves up. Some dogs will go to steroids, things like prednisone. But there's actually some new drugs that are really good for pets just to kind of kill that itch cycle. Actually, we just started using a new injectable product, and it's called CADI, C-A-D-I, and it's really exciting. It stops kind of the pathway, the signals in the itch cycle. So for pets with allergies or a lot of other things, even things like skin mites, it can help to kind of make them more comfortable within as quick as a day. So that's actually not so much a drug. It's more what we call a monoclonal antibody.
Sure.
So kind of exciting stuff there.
Now, you were talking about Benadryl. I got to ask this dog. Mm-hmm. Benadryl, the same kind that humans take?
Yeah, certainly it is. Now, we always do this with your doctor's direction, because the dose we base off of the pet's overall health and whether or not they have other concurrent problems. We can use Benadryl. There's other antihistamines that are used in people, like sometimes we'll use Zyrtec, or hydroxyzine is another one that people use.
Back to the Benadryl, is it a higher dose than what humans take?
It is actually higher. For large dogs, I mean, people take a 25 milligram Benadryl.
Yeah.
And large dogs might take 50 milligrams or more. So it would put us under the table for probably a day and a half.
Yep.
Yeah. And I don't like to discuss doses on the radio, just because, you know, I don't know all your pet's specific diagnoses, so I can't really advise you on how much you should give. But, you know, you can definitely talk to your doctor about a specific drug dose for her.
Where can I purchase that CADI at?
Well, it is an injection, and that'll only be at your veterinarian. And it is a new product, so you may have to kind of check around to see. But that, plus some of the other drugs, there's one called Apoquel that's really fabulous for dogs with allergies. We just have to do a little more kind of screening and checking with pets with
that
one.
I just feel sorry for it. I feel scratching. There's nothing I can do about it, you know?
Yeah, well, there are some things, but we just really have to kind of, in any situation, what I usually do is I'll say, okay, this is what I would like to do to figure out what's the cause. And then these are some of the therapies we might use. And depending on the budget, honestly, and how long the pet's had the problem, we kind of pick and choose what we need to do. So if it's a matter that, say, we have a kind of a narrow budget to work with, we may say, okay, I'd like to test these minimal things, but let's try these steps. And that might be treating for mites with one of these oral products.
Right.
It might be using a shampoo. It might be making sure we're doing some good flea control, and then maybe something to help with the itch. So I think there's a lot of things that can be done, but the first step is kind of asking for help and making sure we start to direct that towards her skin.
Well, thank you so much, Doctor.
Thank you. Sam, we wish you the best of luck. If you have any more questions or need a follow-up, just give us a call toll-free at 1-866-405-8405. Sam calling from Pasadena, listening on Coast 103.5. If you'd like to talk to Dr. Debbie right now, call us toll-free at 1-866-405-8405, and she'll dole out some great advice, second opinions. We have lots of people they'll call and say, I just want a second opinion or a third opinion.
Or just an opinion.
Just an opinion. Toll-free.
Or just Dr. Debbie's opinion.
Yes. And really, she's the only one educated here to give a valid opinion. Right. She went to school for that. We're just, the rest of us, we're just radio lackeys, lucky to have a job. And we
Come on now, everybody's got a Dr. Google degree. Come on.
I know. Do you hate that when people come into your office and they say, well, I looked it up on Google and this is what my dog has?
Okay, you know what? There's good times and then there's bad times where that can make things better or worse. But I will tell you, I have to admit, when I have symptoms for myself, I often pull the internet out and will try to self-diagnose. I see it as a challenge and a puzzle. It's, you know, I don't always, I know I'm not always right, but it's just, I like to try to figure it out before I go there. And I think people do the same thing about their pets.
Oh, sure. Oh, yeah, definitely. Well, I know for me, I'll go to WebMD and you put in a few symptoms and suddenly I have cancer or the gremlins. I'm not really sure. But
you have 6 months to live.
Yeah, that's usually it. WebMD has not been good to me. They've ended my life already like four or five times. So I can understand how it would be with the animals. And I guess it's important to be an informed client. But maybe not making the diagnoses that you should be making, right?
Sure, yeah. That's very true. Be seeking out that veterinary confirmation of your diagnosis.
Bingo, that's it.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Now an Animal Radio news brief.
I'm Stacey Cohen for Animal Radio. Well, if you've got a dog, you probably talk to him. And a study in Current Biology reveals that dogs pay attention to what we say and how we say it. The study used eye tracking techniques that's similar to methods that they use to evaluate babies. Josef Topol of the Hungarian Academy of Science concludes that dogs indeed read our facial expressions and just don't rely on verbal commands. He contends that the interactions become part of their social development. For instance, humans kneeling on the floor to play with their dogs, they'll notice more direct eye contact and subsequently more of a desire on the dog's part to communicate than if the human just throws a toy without direct eye contact with their four-legged companion. So what you want to do is get on the floor and bark like a dog. If you want to keep your dog's attention and you spend a lot of time talking to them, keep talking to them. It really seems to work, and it makes the bond between dogs and humans even stronger.
This has been an Animal Radio News Brief. Get more at animalradio.pet.
This is Animal Radio.
Ah, the sounds of summer. And this is the sound of summer skin being scratched because of the itching and irritation of what the season can bring. You need the fast relief of Cortisone 10 Intensive Healing Anti-Itch Cream. Unlike regular lotions, Cortisone 10 relieves itch and irritation with 1% hydrocortisone, the strongest non-prescription itch medicine, plus 7 healing moisturizers. Cortisone 10 makes summer sound fun again. Cortisone 10. Feel the heal. Use as directed.
Here at Animal Radio, we are not speciesists. We love animals of all sorts, all kinds of breeds, all kinds of animals. And if you happen to have a Yorkshire Terrier, a Shih Tzu, a Pug, or a Mini Schnauzer, these particular animals, there's a great how-to guide for them. And Dr. Debbie wrote it. It's How to Be Your Dog's Best Friend. They are Kindle books. They're available over at Amazon, and we have links from animalradio.pet. Hey, Dan, how are you doing?
Good. How are you?
Good. Where are you calling from today?
Southern Illinois, headed to Minnesota.
Well, what's going on? How can we help you?
Well, I'm calling about a macaw that my wife got about a week ago. And she bought this macaw. It's about 3 months old. And when we brought it home, we noticed, you know how they spread their wings and kind of stretch out?
Mm-hmm.
The left wing is fully formed in there, but the right wing ends at, like, the elbow.
Oh.
You can't really tell that the right wing isn't all there until it spreads its wings out. And then it's like, well, yeah, that doesn't look right, you know? So the bird's tried to fly once or twice, and it'll take off from the cage, and it won't nosedive into the ground or anything, but it doesn't get any loft.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess what the question is this somewhat normal at all for birds to be born with a deformity like this, or is this maybe something that just hasn't fully grown yet?
Okay, well, that's very interesting. You know, I'm always, Dr. Debbie always like kind of likes the weird and strange things, mm-hmm. and I wish I could see your bird's wing because it sounds very interesting and something that I do think a vet should take a look at, especially because we are a juvenile. A young bird, you know, if this was something that was more of a growth deformity, we want to intervene when they're young. However, if this wing is short and you just, like, say there's half the wing that is on the other side, yeah, it could be a congenital deformity. And while that's not necessarily what we would call normal, it isn't uncommon. And we can definitely see birds born with various deformities, whether they affect the wing or the limb. So it definitely can happen. But I would definitely encourage you to just because some of these guys can get some different kinds of contracture. So basically tightening down of the soft tissues and those kind of things we may be able to help and do something for. But if there's only half a wing on that side, it's not going to grow in. Kind of what you got is what you got. But I would hope we could preserve what God did give this bird and hopefully, you know, keep him comfortable and you know, not have that create more of a problem. And I would be very cautious with allowing the bird to jump and to do starts and flying because that's actually how we break the good wing. A lot of times when birds jump, if we don't have the lift that he needs to get up, you know, we can definitely land on the ground, put the wings down, and fracture the opposite side. So be very cautious with that. That's something you have certainly have a special needs bird that is going to need a little extra attention and not that the bird can't live a, you know, healthy, normal life, yeah. But may not just be a flight bird. That's all.
Right. He seems to be fine. He doesn't try to fly much, but like if my wife puts him on, you know, they've got their little perches that they pull around behind him that he sits on. And if she walks into the other room and leaves him on the perch, well, he doesn't like that. Which is kind of unique because they've only been together for a week and this bird's already attached to her.
But, oh, that happens quick, yeah.
real quick. So she'll walk into the other room and he doesn't want to let her out of his sight. So he'll try to, you know, get into that next room, but he can't. Mm-hmm. Of course, there's no lock. He can't fly. And he does climb around on stuff a lot, too. So he, you know, of course, being 3 months old, I'm sure his balance isn't really all the best. So he does fall mm-hmm. and hit the floor every once in a while. But he gets back up and, you know, starts climbing around and doing whatever. As far as the wings go, he does use his wings a lot when he's climbing around. He uses them like we would use our arms. But that's where we're noticing, you know, obviously that the wing is shorter. And we're just wondering, we don't really want him to fly anyways because, you know, she takes him outside on, you know, hot days and so on and so forth. And we don't want him to have to fly. Of course, if it's going to save us money and not have to clip his wings, that's always a good thing, too. We just wanted to make sure that there wasn't going to be any other repercussions down the line, you know, as he gets older from some sort of deformity that we don't know anything about. I mean, we tried to Google it, and we couldn't even find anything on that. So
yeah, that's the challenge. Yeah, I think a vet's going to need to put their eyeballs on things, and in many cases, we'll even need to shoot a quick x-ray just to see what bones are there, because a lot of times, you know, we can take an x-ray and see that there's congenitally a lack of certain bones, or that there was a previous fracture or something like that. So, yeah, I think it's well worth you getting into the vet at this point.
Okay.
Hope that helps out, Dan. Thanks for listening. 1-866-405-8405.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Dogs or cats, horse or emu, animals are people too.
In Cincinnati, a lucky 7-year-old girl won an 8-pound lobster in a local supermarket raffle. But the lobster was really the lucky one. Miranda Hutchins was determined to win Bubba the Lobster so she could set him free. Easier said than done. After winning, Miranda's family called and emailed zoos and aquariums, but none of them wanted Bubba. Finally, Mike Britson from the Columbus Zoo contacted a diver in Maine who agreed to find Bubba a home in the Atlantic. Miranda's family spent $280 to send Bubba to Maine in a foam container. Bubba should be safe from the dinner plate in Maine waters where lobsters his size are illegal to catch and keep. I'm Britt Savage for Animal Radio.
Animals are people too. Animal Radio.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Find us at animalradio.com. Log on, learn more.
Every year, thousands overpay for a used car. They're left feeling disappointed, ashamed, and alone. Traditional pricing books only add to the confusion, offering only guesstimates and ranges. Carfax has a better way. When you search used cars at Carfax.com, you get the most accurate price based on the Carfax report. So you never have to overpay on a used car again. Start your used car search today at Carfax.com.
This is an Animal Radio News Update.
I'm Lori Brooks. I know I have always preferred to say goodbye to my pets in my home rather than a vet's office, but vets these days are getting the message and beginning to make a lot of changes to their end-of-life protocol that they do in offices so that their clients and pets are more comfortable there and have a better experience. Many vet offices now provide what they're calling a comfort room with leather couches, really soft carpeting, candles, usually electric candles, soft music and serenity gardens with water fountains, among those being some of the special touches. But those vet offices making these changes will often, too, make arrangements for cremation and take payment in advance over the phone so that as a grieving owner, so you don't have to deal with paperwork or questions once you're at the clinic, because let's face it, just being there and not crying is hard enough to do. But many vets also offer memorial art, too, featuring a paw print of a dog or a cat. They even do ear prints for rabbits or a tail print for rats. And that gives the owner something to go home with from that appointment that day. And one animal hospital in Oregon takes it a step further, even holding a monthly workshop for people who want to place a pet's ashes inside something like a piece of art or jewelry. It's come a long way.
Yeah, and I have to say, you know, these changes I've seen in the time of, you know, my career, whereas, you know, of my two offices, one, we have the room and space, and we have a comfort room, and the other one, we try to make do with what we have that still has to be useful for other things. But I think a lot of what you're mentioning is, it's, we know that's what people want, and, you know, it's kind of the changes coming.
I think it's a really, really good thing. Glad to see it. Los Angeles is going to become the largest city in the U.S. to ban the sale of fur. The city council there has voted unanimously to move forward with the ban, which they say is going to take effect in 24 months after the final language is passed. And then the ban will prohibit the sale of coats, purses, shoes, hats, just about anything, jewelry, and any other products that are made in whole or in part from fur.
Wow, I got to think, especially in Los Angeles, that there will be an underground market, and it will be kind of, you know, taboo to in a desirable way for some people to own a fur, because obviously so many people own furs, especially in Los Angeles already.
Kardashians.
Yeah.
So, what about the retailers? I mean, I'm just kind of looking on the other side. Do they have a pushback that, you know, hey, you're telling me what I can and can't sell? Do they? I mean, this is California. I mean, yeah, there's a lot of stars Beverly and wealthy people there.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to see how that goes through and if there's an appeal on it.
But I don't really think what you said, Hal, because it seems like the area is so much more liberal, which I don't think is a bad thing. But so much really into animal rights, maybe, is what I mean to say, that this comes as just an extension of that to most of the people there.
Well, you remember when Bob Barker, he decided not to host, was it Miss America pageant?
Oh, yeah, one of those.
That's right.
Because they were wearing furs. Mm-hmm. That he took a stand, but that was years ago.
And he was way ahead of his time and all that. He was so awesome with that.
Yeah, we should say
we have to have him back on.
Yeah, he's still around, yeah, so let's say is.
Yeah. Well, now that fall has arrived, winter is not too far off. In a real snowy city, the felines of Denver are going to be the stars as the city hosts the Snow Cats Cat Convention for a weekend of cats, art, and music. It's coming up on December 8th and 9th. You want to mark that down because they're going to be showcasing adoptable cats. They're going to have an on-site cat cafe and lounge so you can imbibe if you would like to. Special guest speakers, musical acts, meet and greets for celebrity felines, a film festival, and the favorite event that they're going to have that we love is the Catchler auction. Like a bachelor auction? A Catchler auction. where they're going to have the finest catmen being auctioned off to raise money for cat charities.
Catmen? Like human
men?
Yeah. That like cats?
Men who like cats, yeah.
Wow. So, huh. Save my money.
I assume you're going to be there, Hal.
Yeah, I'll be auctioning myself off there.
Hey, you should offer yourself, Hal. Aren't you from Denver?
I am from Denver.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No.
And you're a cat guy. Animal Radio, it's perfect. Al?
I would be so embarrassed if I only fetched like $50.
Oh, come on. It's good publicity.
I would be there as a backup and make sure you went for at least 51.
Yeah. Thanks. I appreciate it.
Yay, Judy. That is true love. I'm Lori Brooks. Get more breaking animal news anytime at animalradio.com.
This has been an Animal Radio News Update. Get more at animalradio.com.
Hi, this is Carrie Annie Nava from Dance with the Stars. Don't forget to spay and neuter your animals, and you're listening to Animal Radio.
Oh, what did he say?
He said we're all across the USA, the most listened to pet show today. Animal Radio, we're everywhere you go. Animal Radio. Animal Radio.
Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Let's hit the phones. We have Ann on the phones. Hi, Ann.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Where are you today?
I'm in Clovis, California.
Oh, near Fresno. Lovely Fresno.
Right, yes.
What can we do for you?
I have a question, and it's possibly if dogs could be allergic to black mission figs. And I'll be real brief. I have a little miniature rat terrier, weighs about 10 pounds, 2.5 years old. Very, very active. Last Monday, we noticed, or 2 weeks ago Monday, we noticed she was dragging her back leg a little bit. By mm-hmm. Tuesday, she couldn't stand up. We had to put a sling under her back legs. She was just dragging them. Took her to the vet. They did that test where they pinched her legs all the way up to the middle of the back. There was no flinching. She was, like, completely paralyzed for 2 days. I thought I was going to have to put her down. The doctor tried a dose of DMSO along with had been given her prednisone.
Okay.
This was on a Thursday. By Friday, she was able to stand on her legs a little bit. By Saturday, she was walking a little wobbly. By Sunday, she was running and chasing the dog along the fence. Mm-hmm. Now, is there a possibility, because a year ago, we almost lost her, and it's exactly a year ago, and they never could find out what was wrong with her then, but she just didn't eat. She was listless and dehydrated and everything.
Hmm. Okay. And you're concerned about the figs being a possible cause of that?
Possibly, or else could she have had, the vet said he took x-rays. There was nothing that jumped out at him, but possibly a ruptured disc or... Yep. A dislocated disc, but could she recover that quickly?
Well, possibly, yeah.
Really?
And when we talk about disc problems in dogs, you know, it's a spongy little cushion between the bones right below the spinal cord. So if one of those very suddenly impacts the spinal cord, causes a lot of pain, can lead to sudden paralysis, some pets can respond very quickly and very favorably to steroids such as prednisone or dexamethasone. So that's possible. And there are some more obscure things that can cause maybe a temporary paralysis. But if with that therapy that he prescribed, she improved, I would actually have some faith perhaps that we may have a bad back and, you know, something to watch for in the future, because a lot of pets can go on to have future episodes with their back. Okay. Whether or not that year prior that was related to that, I don't know. You know, but some pets with early back problems will be uncomfortable. They just don't act themselves. They may be grumpy even and not necessarily show signs of paralysis. So, you know, I can make a case for that perhaps. Generally, I can tell you figs are pretty harmless to dogs unless they eat lots of them, and then you get nice mushy poops.
Okay. But I thought possibly because it was exactly almost to the day a year ago we had a problem with her, and they never could figure out what was wrong with her. And I thought, is it possible? But so then we're looking at a disc, probably a back problem.
Very likely. And, you know, I can make some really weird diagnosis out there. There are some types of like moldy foods that can actually cause they have basically a mycotoxin, a type of a fungus that is toxic to the neurologic system. So some pets can have that if they get into old dairy products, you know, garbage, even some old nuts sometimes, things like that can cause those problems. So that's a possibility, but that's kind of a far stretch. And usually we have some pretty good information that a pet's kind of gotten into some things they shouldn't to cause that. So, yeah, I would definitely be sure that with your rat terrier that we're watching things that can be signs of back problems, reluctance to jump up and down, and just make special accommodations. Be ready that if we do have future back things, this is definitely not a pet we want to be very athletic, jumping off high areas in the home. So we use a little extra caution, maybe even use a harness, you know, for walking purposes. So that would be my guess there, Anne.
Your guess there. Okay. Like I said, I was curious, but it's unbelievable. I mean, we were looking at little doggy carts on the internet and even thought possibly we're going to have to put her down.
Well, I'm glad it turned out like it did. I mean, that's it's to make a recovery like that is great.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. Oh. And thank you very much for your call today, calling from Fresno, California, listening on KYNO AM 1300. Thank you. 1-866-405-8405 to talk to anyone on the Dream Team right now.
You're listening to Animal Radio. Call the Dream Team now at 1-866-405-8405.
Hi, this is Bob Barker on Animal Radio, reminding you to help control the pet population. Have your pet spayed or neutered.
GEICO presents Unhelpful Home Improvement How-Tos.
An overflowing toilet can wreak havoc on your home. So today, I'll show you how to avoid a flood by installing the toilet in your bathtub. All you need is a plumber's wrench and a hose clamp. This easy modification not only stops flooding, it also cuts down on morning prep time.
You could try to protect your home with a tub toilet, or you could get covered for personal property damage through the GEICO Insurance Agency. Call GEICO and see how affordable homeowners insurance can be.
Here are today's automotive news headlines. I'm Nick Miles. BMW roll out the new X5 in Atlanta almost 20 years after the first generation X5 was shown to America in the same city. The new X5 is the fourth generation of the groundbreaking segment SUV, and for 2019 it comes packed with high levels of tech and features. Now you can take your feet off the pedals and hands off the steering wheel in stop and go traffic in certain circumstances. The vehicle will automatically navigate if speeds are under 37 miles an hour. For more, go to ourautoexpert.com.
Think O'Reilly Auto Parts for all of your car needs. We're close, convenient, and known for our guaranteed everyday low prices and excellent customer service from professional parts people you can trust. Stop by your local O'Reilly Auto Parts today. O'Reilly Auto Parts. Better parts, better prices every day.
This is
Animal Radio.
You know, Halloween is just around the corner here. You can tell Judy already has up all the Halloween costumes around the studio that she's going to or planning to put on all the animals.
Yes.
I believe, Dr. Debbie, you get into this. Lori, I believe you even dress up some of your dogs, don't you?
Every day. Almost every day.
I'm not crazy like that. I do enjoy the good festivities. You know, the Christmas hats, you know, the little elf hats. I like that around the holidays. And then, of course, Halloween is a big favorite of mine.
Do the animals like it? That's the question.
You know what? My dogs are so food motivated that they will endure anything for a piece of watermelon. They just love it. So I get the photo ops. I don't torture them and leave it on them. It's not something they would want on all day. But, you know, for a cute photo, they don't mind it.
Every year you always see these pet costumes that come out. Many of them not very original, like the hot dog.
Yeah.
But you know what? We came across some really very original and very unique costumes, and we actually got to sample a couple. I have pictures here. This is Molly. Is this Molly, the studio stunt dog?
This is Molly, the studio dog. Yes.
She is wearing a...
A lion mane.
A lion mane, and she looks very much like a lion there.
She does. And she's only like 7-8 pounds.
And you have one over here. Is this one you're going to give away?
Yes, this is a mermaid. And I was looking at it. It looks like it could fit a dog maybe 15 pounds or so, maybe 10 to 20 pounds. Mm.
We have Allison Albert. She's the founder of Pet Crew. And that's spelled with a K, P-E-T-K-R-E-W-E. And she's offering fun, high quality, and very unique pet costumes. Welcome to the show, Allison.
Hey, thanks for having me.
So I got to ask, is this something you do all year round? You create costumes for animals?
We do. We create costumes year round. And we believe every day is a reason to celebrate and dress your pets up, not just for Halloween, but every day you can unleash your own parade.
Now, I guess we're not alone here in the studios. 16% of American families actually dress up their animals for Halloween?
That's correct. And about 4% pre-plan their pet's costume to match their costume 6 months before Halloween.
Wow.
See, I would think that percentage would be higher.
So tell us a little bit about the costumes you have, because they're all very unique. And I wish this was television. As you describe them, I will hold up pictures to the microphone for those listeners that...
Sure. So since you guys had mentioned the mermaid costume, this is one of our favorite costumes. On the tail, it's color-changing sequins that you can change it from a seafoam green to an emerald green, or seafoam blue to emerald green. And we're gender neutral over here. So if you want to remove your seashells, you can and create a merman or create a mermaid, however your dog feels, whatever your dog is feeling for that day. And then we also have some of my other favorite costumes that we sell are our unicorn hats for cats and unicorn hats for dogs. These come with like a little rainbow mane and a sparkly unicorn horn. And these are so much fun. We hand dye the fur fabric on the mane. So each one's a little different and a little unique.
So I got to ask, is there a dog, perhaps your dog, that is the, let's say, guinea pig for these costumes?
Well, we do have several. We call them our interns. The interns at the office. The interns do enjoy dressing up because they always know that a treat's right behind the costume. So we do dress them up. But on a whole, for all of our spec pictures and the pictures that go on within our products that we sell, we go right down the street to Jefferson SCCA, and we use adoptable dogs to photograph in our costumes. And aww, it serves as their gotcha adoption pictures as well as an amazing stock photo. And so we work with the dogs to get them used to human touch and playing with them. And we never force it. If they don't want to wear a costume, we're cool with that. But for the day-to-day Instagram snaps, we use our interns.
So you're working on something that makes your business, your costume business, just a little bit different. And you're going to have to explain it in the most basic terms, because I'm not a real techie guy. You know, I didn't think that interweb thingy or the faceplant would take off. So I need to be explained. What is this augmented reality that you're working on, and how does it tie into with what you're doing?
Sure. So we know that our customer wants more than just a pet costume. They want an experience. So we came up with the idea of using augmented reality that creates crazy worlds that complement your pet costume purchase from Pet Crew. So let me walk you through Pet Crew Go.
Okay.
What that means is if you got the mermaid outfit, you dress your dog up as a mermaid, and then you go to either Apple, iTunes, or Google Play, and you download Pet Crew Go. Once you download it, it'll open up, and you can say, I got the mermaid costume. I want to go to under the sea world. So you select the world. And as your dog is sitting there in the costume looking fabulous as a mermaid, you can start to place mermaids around your dog. So you can have a gossip of mermaids, and then you can put fish there. So it actually looks like real fish are swimming around your dog, who's the mermaid, and going under the sea. You can plant coral reefs right beside your dog. And then you can take a picture of your pup with this amazing digital backdrop.
Cool.
Wow.
Or this video where your dog is walking through coral reefs with mermaids sitting on the banks, flapping their tails, and fish swimming around your dog. And you can create a fun video, and it's all free.
Wow.
Well, that's awesome.
Yeah,
that is.
Well, we're going to give away a mermaid.
Yes.
You sent us this mermaid. Now, this is what size would you say this is here? What kind of dog would have to wear this?
So we, with the adjustable strap, so it would probably fit anything from a small little mixed terrier up to a pug.
And it has the two little shells, too, which you can opt to use or not. If you'd like to pick up on this right now, toll-free 1-866-405-8405. If we're not lucky enough to get on through, what's the website?
It's petcrew.com, and that's P-E-T-K-R-E-W-E.com. crew is colloquial here in New Orleans for a social club, and we welcome everyone to be part of the crew here.
Thanks, Allison, for spending time with us today. Once again, it has just flown by. We have so much fun with you. If you need your fix during the week, head on over to animalradio.pet or download the Animal Radio app for iPhone, Android, and BlackBerry.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
This is Animal Radio Network.